Wicked Captain Walshy, of Walling, Joseph Sheridan Le Fanu, Chapter 1. Peg O'Neill pays the captain's debts. A very odd thing happened to my uncle, Mr. Watson, of Haddlestone, and to enable you to understand it, I must begin at the beginning. In the year 1822, Mr. James Walshy, more commonly known as Captain Walshy, died at the age of 81 years. The captain in his early days, and so long as health and strength permitted, was a scamp of the active, intriguing sort, and spent his days and nights in sowing his wild oats, of which he seemed to have an inexhaustible stock. The harvest of this tillage was plentifully interspersed with thorns, nettles, and thistles, which stung the husbandman unpleasantly, and did not enrich him. Captain Walshy was very well known in the neighbourhood of Walling, and very generally avoided there. A captain by courtesy, for he had never reached that rank in the army list. He had quitted the service in 1766, at the age of 25, immediately previous to which period his debts had grown so troublesome, that he was induced to extricate himself by running away with and marrying an heiress, though not so wealthy quite as he had imagined. She proved a very comfortable investment for what remained of his shattered affections, and he lived and enjoyed himself very much in his old way, upon her income, getting into no end of scrapes and scandals, and a good deal of debt and money trouble. When he married his wife, he was quartered in Ireland, at Clonmel, where was a nunnery, in which, as pensioner, resided Miss O'Neill, or as she was called in the country, Peg O'Neill, the heiress of whom I have spoken. Her situation was the only ingredient of romance in the affair, for the young lady was decidedly plain, though good-humoured looking, with that style of features which is termed potato, and in figure she was a little too plump, and rather short. But she was impressible, and the handsome young English lieutenant was too much for her monastic tendencies, and she eloped. In England there are traditions of Irish fortune hunters, and in Ireland of English. The fact is, it was the vagrant class of each country that chiefly visited the other in old times, and a handsome vagabond, whether at home or abroad, I suppose, made the most of his face, which was also his fortune. At all events, he carried off the fair one from the sanctuary, and for some sufficient reason, I suppose, they took up their abode at Walling, in Lancashire. Here the gallant captain amused himself after his fashion, sometimes running up, of course on business, to London. I believe few wives have ever cried more in a given time than did that poor, dumpy, potato-faced heiress, who got over the nunnery garden wall, and jumped into the handsome captain's arms. For love, he spent her income, frightened her out of her wits with oaths and threats, and broke her heart. Latterly she shut herself up pretty nearly altogether in her room. She had an old, rather grim, Irish servant woman in attendance upon her. This domestic was tall, lean, and religious, and the captain knew instinctively she hated him, and he hated her in return, often threatened to put her out of the house, and sometimes even to kick her out of the window. And whenever a wet day confined him to the house, or the stable, and he grew tired of smoking, he would begin to swear and curse at her for a diddled old mischief maker, that could never be easy, and was always troubling the house with her cursed stories, and so forth. But years passed away, and old Molly Doyle remained still in her original position. Perhaps he thought that there must be somebody there, and that he was not, after all, very likely to change for the better. Chapter 2. The Blessed Candle. He tolerated another intrusion, too, and thought himself a paragon of patience and easy good nature for so doing. A Roman Catholic clergyman, in a long black frock, with a low-standing collar, and a little white muslin fillet round his neck, tall, sallow, with blue chin, and dark steady eyes, used to glide up and down the stairs, and through the passages, and the captain sometimes met him in one place and sometimes in another. But by a caprice incident to such tempers he treated this cleric exceptionally, and even with a surly sort of courtesy, though he grumbled about his visits behind his back. I do not know that he had a great deal of moral courage, and the ecclesiastic looked severe and self-possessed, and somehow he thought he had no good opinion of him, and if a natural occasion were offered, might say extremely unpleasant things, and hard to be answered. Well, the time came at last, when poor Peg O'Neill in an evil hour Mrs. James Walshy must cry, and quake, and pray her last. The doctor came from Penlandon, and was just as vague as usual, but more gloomy, and for about a week came and went oftener. The cleric in the long black frock was also daily there. And at last came that last sacrament in the gates of death, when the sinner is traversing those dread steps that never can be retraced, when the face is turned forever from life, and we see a receding shape, and hear a voice already irrevocably in the land of spirits. So the poor lady died, and some people said the captain felt it very much. I don't think he did. But he was not very well just then, and looked the part of mourner and penitent in admiration, being seedy and sick. He drank a great deal of brandy and water that night, and called in Farmer Dobbs, for want of better company, to drink with him, and told him all his grievances, and how happy he and the poor lady upstairs might have been, had it not been for Lias, and Pickthanks, and talebearers, and the like, who came between them, meaning Molly Doyle, whom, as he waxed eloquent over his liquor, he came at last to curse and rail at by name, with more than his accustomed freedom. And he described his own natural character and amiability in such moving terms, that he wept maudlin tears of sensibility over his theme, and when Dobbs was gone, drank some more grog, and took to railing and cursing again by himself, and then mounted the stairs unsteadily, to see what the devil Doyle and the other old witches were about in poor Peg's room. When he pushed open the door, he found some half dozen crones, chiefly Irish, from the neighbouring town of Hackleton, sitting over tea and snuff, etc., with candles lighted round the corpse, which was arrayed in a strangely cut robe of brown serge. She had secretly belonged to some order, I think the Carmelite, but I am not certain, and wore the habit in her coffin. "What the dear are you doing with my wife?" cried the captain, rather thickly. "How dare you dress her up in this trumpery, you cheating old witch, and what's that candle doing in her hand?" I think he was a little startled, for the spectacle was grisly enough. The dead lady was arrayed in this strange brown robe, and in her rigid fingers, as in a socket, with the large wooden beads and cross wound round it, burned a wax candle, shedding its white light over the sharp features of the corpse. Molly Doyle was not to be put down by the captain, whom she hated, and accordingly, in her phrase, he got as good as he gave. And the captain's wrath waxed fiercer, and he chucked the wax taper from the dead hand, and was on the point of flinging it at the old serving woman's head. "The holy candle, you sinner!" cried she. "I've a mind to make you eat it, you beast!" cried the captain, but I think he had not known before what it was, for he subsided a little sulkily, and he stuffed his hand with the candle, quite extinct by this time, into his pocket, and said he, "You know devilish well you had no business going on with why or d witchcraft about my poor wife, without my leave you do, and you'll please take off that d brown pinafore, and get her decently into her coffin, and I'll pitch your devil's wax light into the sink." And the captain stalked out of the room. "And now her poor soul's in prison, you wretch, be the manes o ye, and may your own be shut into the wick o' that same candle, till it's burned out, ye savage. I'd have you ducked for a witch, for twopence," roared the captain up the staircase, with his hand on the banisters, standing on the lobby. But the door of the chamber of death clapped angrily, and he went down to the parlour, where he examined the holy candle for a while, with a tipsy gravity, and then with something of that reverential feeling for the symbolic, which is not uncommon in rakes and scamps. He thoughtfully locked it up in a press, where were accumulated all sorts of obsolete rubbish: soiled packs of cards, disused tobacco pipes, broken powder flasks, his military sword, and a dusky bundle of the Flash Songster, and other questionable literature. He did not trouble the dead lady's room any more. Being a volatile man, it is probable that more cheerful plans and occupations began to entertain his fancy. Chapter 3. My Uncle Watson Visits Walling. So the poor lady was buried decently, and Captain Walshay reigned alone for many years at Walling. He was too shrewd and too experienced by this time to run violently down the steep hill that leads to ruin. So there was a method in his madness, and after a widowed career of more than 40 years, he, too, died at last with some guineas in his purse. 40 years and upwards is a great edax rerum, and a wonderful chemical power. It acted forcibly upon the gay Captain Walshay. Gout supervened, and was no more conducive to temper than to enjoyment, and made his elegant hands lumpy at all the small joints, and turned them slowly into crippled claws. He grew stout when his exercise was interfered with, and ultimately almost corpulent. He suffered from what Mr. Holloway calls bad legs, and was wheeled about in a great leathern back chair, and his infirmities went on accumulating with his years. I am sorry to say, I never heard that he repented, or turned his thoughts seriously to the future. On the contrary, his talk grew fouler, and his fun ran upon his favourite sins, and his temper waxed more truculent. But he did not sink into dotage. Considering his bodily infirmities, his energies and his malignities, which were many and active, were marvellously little abated by time. So he went on to the close. When his temper was stirred, he cursed and swore in a way that made decent people tremble. It was a word and a blow with him, the latter, luckily, not very sure now. But he would seize his crutch and make a swoop or a pound at the offender, or shy his medicine bottle, or his tumbler, at his head. It was a peculiarity of Captain Walshay, that he, by this time, hated nearly everybody. My uncle, Mr. Watson, of Haddlestone, was cousin to the captain, and his heir at law. but my uncle had lent him money on mortgage of his estates. And there had been a treaty to sell, and terms and a price were agreed upon, in articles which the lawyers said were still in force. I think the ill-conditioned captain bore him a grudge for being richer than he, and would have liked to do him an ill turn. But it did not lie in his way, at least while he was living. My uncle Watson was a Methodist, and what they call a class leader, and, on the whole, a very good man. He was now near 50 grave, as beseemed his profession somewhat dry and a little severe, perhaps but a just man. A letter from the Penland and doctor reached him at Haddlestone, announcing the death of the wicked old captain, and suggesting his attendance at the funeral, and the expediency of his being on the spot to look after things at Walling. The reasonableness of this striking my good uncle, he made his journey to the old house in Lancashire incontinently, and reached it in time for the funeral. My uncle, whose traditions of the captain were derived from his mother, who remembered him in his slim, handsome youth in shorts, cocked hat and lace, was amazed at the bulk of the coffin which contained his mortal remains, but the lid being already screwed down, he did not see the face of the bloated old sinner. Chapter 4 In the parlour. What I relate, I had from the lips of my uncle, who was a truthful man, and not prone to fancies. The day turning out awfully rainy and tempestuous, he persuaded the doctor and the attorney to remain for the night at Walling. There was no will, the attorney was sure of that, for the captain's enmities were perpetually shifting, and he could never quite make up his mind, as to how best to give effect to a malignity whose direction was constantly being modified. He had had instructions for drawing a will a dozen times over, but the process had always been arrested by the intending testator. Search being made, no will was found. The papers, indeed, were all right, with one important exception: the leases were nowhere to be seen. There were special circumstances connected with several of the principal tenancies on the estate, unnecessary here to detail, which rendered the loss of these documents one of very serious moment, and even of very obvious danger. My uncle, therefore, searched strenuously. The attorney was at his elbow, and the doctor helped with a suggestion now and then. The old serving man seemed an honest deaf creature, and really knew nothing. My uncle Watson was very much perturbed. He fancied, but this possibly was only fancy, that he had detected for a moment a queer look in the attorney's face, and from that instant it became fixed in his mind that he knew all about the leases. Mr. Watson expounded that evening in the parlour to the doctor, the attorney, and the deaf servant. Ananias and Sapphira figured in the foreground, and the awful nature of fraud and theft, of tampering in otherwise with the plain rule of honesty in matters pertaining to estates, etc., were pointedly dwelt upon. And then came a long and strenuous prayer, in which he entreated with fervour and aplomb that the hard heart of the sinner who had abstracted the leases might be softened or broken in such a way as to lead to their restitution, or that, if he continued reserved and contumacious, it might at least be the will of heaven to bring him to public justice and the document's delight. The fact is, that he was praying all this time at the attorney. When these religious exercises were over, the visitors retired to their rooms, and my uncle Watson wrote two or three pressing letters by the fire. When his task was done, it had grown late, the candles were flaring in their sockets, and all in bed, and, I suppose, asleep, but the fire was nearly out. He chilly, and the flame of the candles throbbing strangely in their sockets, shed alternate glare and shadow round the old wainscoted room and its quaint furniture. Outside were all the wild thunder and piping of the storm, and the rattling of distant windows sounded through the passages, and down the stairs, like angry people astir in the house. My uncle Watson belonged to a sect who by no means rejected the supernatural, and whose founder, on the contrary, has sanctioned ghosts in the most emphatic way. He was glad therefore to remember, that in prosecuting his search that day, he had seen some 6 inches of wax candle in the press in the parlour, for he had no fancy to be overtaken by darkness in his present situation. He had no time to lose, and taking the bunch of keys of which he was now master, he soon fitted the lock, and secured the candle, a treasure in his circumstances, and lighting it, he stuffed it into the socket of one of the expiring candles, and extinguishing the other, he looked round the room in the steady light reassured. At the same moment, an unusual violent gust of the storm blew a handful of gravel against the parlour window, with a sharp rattle that startled him in the midst of the roar and hubbub, and the flame of the candle itself was agitated by the air. Chapter 5 The Bedchamber. My uncle walked up to bed, guarding his candle with his hand, for the lobby windows were rattling furiously, and he disliked the idea of being left in the dark more than ever. His bedroom was comfortable, though old-fashioned. He shut and bolted the door. There was a tall looking-glass opposite the foot of his four-poster, on the dressing-table between the windows. He tried to make the curtains meet, but they would not draw, and like many a gentleman in a like perplexity, he did not possess a pin. nor was there one in the huge pincushion beneath the glass. He turned the face of the mirror away therefore, so that its back was presented to the bed, pulled the curtains together, and placed a chair against them, to prevent their falling open again. There was a good fire, and a reinforcement of round coal and wood inside the fender. So he piled it up to ensure a cheerful blaze through the night, and placing a little black mahogany table, with the legs of a satyr, beside the bed, and his candle upon it, he got between the sheets, and laid his red night-capped head upon his pillow, and disposed himself to sleep. The first thing that made him uncomfortable was a sound at the foot of his bed, quite distinct in a momentary lull of the storm. It was only the gentle rustle and rush of the curtains, which fell open again, and as his eyes opened, he saw them resuming their perpendicular dependence, and sat up in his bed almost expecting to see something uncanny in the aperture. There was nothing, however, but the dressing table, and other dark furniture, and the window curtains faintly undulating in the violence of the storm. He did not care to get up, therefore the fire being bright and cheery to replace the curtains by a chair, in the position in which he had left them, anticipating possibly a new recurrence of the relapse which had startled him from his incipient doze. So he got to sleep in a little while again, but he was disturbed by a sound, as he fancied, at the table on which stood the candle. He could not say what it was, only that he wakened with a start, and lying so in some amaze, he did distinctly hear a sound which startled him a good deal, though there was nothing necessarily supernatural in it. He described it as resembling what would occur if you fancied a thinnish table leaf, with a convex warp in it, depressed the reverse way, and suddenly with a spring recovering its natural convexity. It was a loud, sudden thump, which made the heavy candlestick jump, and there was an end, except that my uncle did not get again into a doze for 10 minutes at least. The next time he awoke, it was in that odd, serene way that sometimes occurs. We open our eyes, we know not why, quite placidly, and are on the instant wide awake. He had had a nap of some duration this time, for his candle flame was fluttering and flaring, in articulo, in the silver socket. But the fire was still bright and cheery, so he popped the extinguisher on the socket, and almost at the same time there came a tap at his door, and a sort of crescendo hush shh. Once more my uncle was sitting up, scared and perturbed, in his bed. He recollected, however, that he had bolted his door, and such inveterate materialists are we in the midst of our spiritualism, that this reassured him, and he breathed a deep sigh, and began to grow tranquil. But after a rest of a minute or two, there came a louder and sharper knock at his door, so that instinctively he called out, "Who's there?" in a loud, stern key. There was no sort of response, however. The nervous effect of the start subsided, and I think my uncle must have remembered how constantly, especially on a stormy night, these creaks or cracks which simulate all manner of goblin noises, make themselves naturally audible. Chapter 6. The extinguisher is lifted. After a while, then, he lay down with his back turned toward that side of the bed at which was the door, and his face toward the table on which stood the massive old candlestick, capped with its extinguisher, and in that position he closed his eyes. But sleep would not revisit them. All kinds of queer fancies began to trouble him. Some of them I remember. He felt the point of a finger, he averred, pressed most distinctly on the tip of his great toe, as if a living hand were between his sheets, and making a sort of signal of attention or silence. Then again he felt something as large as a rat make a sudden bounce in the middle of his bolster, just under his head. Then a voice said, "Oh!" very gently, close at the back of his head. All these things he felt certain of, and yet investigation led to nothing. He felt odd little cramps stealing now and then about him, and then, on a sudden, the middle finger of his right hand was plucked backwards, with a light playful jerk that frightened him awfully. Meanwhile the storm kept singing, and howling, and ha-ha-hooing hoarsely among the limbs of the old trees and the chimney pots, and my uncle Watson, although he prayed and meditated as was his wont when he lay awake, felt his heart throb excitedly, and sometimes thought he was beset with evil spirits, and at others that he was in the early stage of a fever. He resolutely kept his eyes closed, however, and, like St. Paul's shipwrecked companions, wished for the day. At last another little doze seems to have stolen upon his senses, for he awoke quietly and completely as before, opening his eyes all at once, and seeing everything as if he had not slept for a moment. The fire was still blazing redly, nothing uncertain in the light. The massive silver candlestick, topped with its dual extinguisher, stood on the center of the black mahogany table as before, and, looking by what seemed a sort of accident to the apex of this, he beheld something which made him quite misdoubt the evidence of his eyes. He saw the extinguisher lifted by a tiny hand, from beneath, and a small human face, no bigger than a thumbnail, with nicely proportioned features, peep from beneath it. In this Lilliputian countenance was such a ghastly consternation as horrified my uncle unspeakably. Out came a little foot then and there, and a pair of wee legs, in short silk stockings and buckled shoes, then the rest of the figure, and, with the arms holding about the socket, the little legs stretched and stretched, hanging about the stem of the candlestick till the feet reached the base, and so down the setter-like leg of the table, till they reached the floor, extending elastically, and strangely enlarging in all proportions as they approached the ground, where the feet and buckles were those of a well-shaped, full-grown man, and the figure tapering upward until it dwindled to its original fairy dimensions at the top, like an object seen in some strangely curved mirror. Standing upon the floor he expanded, my amazed uncle could not tell how, into his proper proportions, and stood pretty nearly in profile at the bedside, a handsome and elegantly shaped young man, in a bygone military costume, with a small laced, three-cocked hat and plume on his head, but looking like a man going to be hanged in unspeakable despair. He stepped lightly to the hearth, and turned for a few seconds very dejectedly with his back toward the bed and the mantelpiece, and he saw the hilt of his rapier glittering in the firelight, and then walking across the room he placed himself at the dressing table, visible through the divided curtains at the foot of the bed. The fire was blazing still so brightly that my uncle saw him as distinctly as if half a dozen candles were burning. Chapter 7 The visitation culminates. The looking-glass was an old-fashioned piece of furniture, and had a drawer beneath it. My uncle had searched it carefully for the papers in the daytime, but the silent figure pulled the drawer quite out, pressed a spring at the side, disclosing a false receptacle behind it, and from this he drew a parcel of papers tied together with pink tape. All this time my uncle was staring at him in a horrified state, neither winking nor breathing, and the apparition had not once given the smallest intimation of consciousness that a living person was in the same room. But now, for the first time, it turned its livid stare full upon my uncle with a hateful smile of significance, lifting up the little parcel of papers between his slender finger and thumb. Then he made a long, cunning wink at him, and seemed to blow out one of his cheeks in a burlesque grimace, which, but for the horrific circumstances, would have been ludicrous. My uncle could not tell whether this was really an intentional distortion or only one of those horrid ripples and deflections which were constantly disturbing the proportions of the figure, as if it were seen through some unequal and perverting medium. The figure now approached the bed, seeming to grow exhausted and malignant as it did so. My uncle's terror nearly culminated at this point, for he believed it was drawing near him with an evil purpose. But it was not so, for the soldier, over whom 20 years seemed to have passed in his brief transit to the dressing table and back again, threw himself into a great high-backed armchair of stuffed leather at the far side of the fire, and placed his heels on the fender. His feet and legs seemed indistinctly to swell, and swathings showed themselves round them, and they grew into something enormous, and the upper figure swayed and shaped itself into corresponding proportions, a great mass of corpulence, with a cadaverous and malignant face, and the furrows of a great old age, and colourless glassy eyes, and with these changes, which came indefinitely but rapidly as those of a sunset cloud, the fine regimentals faded away, and a loose, grey, woolen drapery, somehow, was there in its stead, and all seemed to be stained and rotten, for swarms of worms seemed creeping in and out, while the figure grew paler and paler, till my uncle, who liked his pipe, and employed the simile naturally, said the whole effigy grew to the colour of tobacco ashes, and the clusters of worms into little wriggling knots of sparks such as we see running over the residuum of a burnt sheet of paper. And so with the strong draught caused by the fire, and the current of air from the window, which was rattling in a storm, the feet seemed to be drawn into the fireplace, and the whole figure, light as ashes, floated away with them, and disappeared with a whisk up the capacious old chimney. It seemed to my uncle that the fire suddenly darkened and the air grew icy cold, and there came an awful roar and riot of tempest, which shook the old house from top to base, and sounded like the yelling of a bloodthirsty mob on receiving a new and long-expected victim. Good Uncle Watson used to say, "I have been in many situations of fear and danger in the course of my life, but never did I pray with so much agony before or since, for then, as now, it was clear beyond a cavil that I had actually beheld the phantom of an evil spirit." Chapter 8 Conclusion. Now there are two curious circumstances to be observed in this relation of my uncle's, who was, as I have said, a perfectly voracious man. First, the wax candle which he took from the press in the parlour and burnt at his bedside on that horrible night was unquestionably, according to the testimony of the old deaf servant, who had been 50 years at Walling, that identical piece of holy candle which had stood in the fingers of the poor lady's corpse, and concerning which the old Irish crone, long since dead, had delivered the curious curse I have mentioned against the captain. Secondly, behind the drawer under the looking glass, he did actually discover a second but secret drawer, in which were concealed the identical papers which he had suspected the attorney of having made away with. There were circumstances, too, afterwards disclosed which convinced my uncle that the old man had deposited them there preparatory to burning them, which he had nearly made up his mind to do. Now, a very remarkable ingredient in this tale of my uncle Watson was this, that so far as my father, who had never seen Captain Walshay in the course of his life, could gather, the phantom had exhibited a horrible and grotesque, but unmistakable resemblance to that defunct scamp in the various stages of his long life. Walling was sold in the year 1837, and the old house shortly after pulled down, and a new one built nearer to the river. I often wonder whether it was rumored to be haunted, and, if so, what stories were current about it. It was a commodious and stanch old house, and withal rather handsome, and its demolition was certainly suspicious.